I'm Lowell Horton, President and CEO of Golden Cross.
If Lowell Horton had succumbed to his earliest entrepreneurial temptation, the world would have been deprived of more than a legendary producer of patties and other culinary delights. For us in Jamaica, Horton's creation, Golden Cross Caribbean Bakery and Grill, has been the quintessential showpiece of the American dream in perpetual motion. With 122 branches in 9 states, 1,800 employees, and more than US $100 million in gross annual sales, Golden Cross is not your average mom and pop store. Even by the standards of the world's largest economy, it is in fact big business. When I came to New York, all I wanted to do was to hustle for 1 year and return to Jamaica with enough money to buy a $250,000 coaster bus, Horton confessed. This was the dream of everybody in the minibus business, to own a coaster. While history will never reveal the outcome of the alternative path not taken, there are ample examples that Jamaica's public transportation business would have made for a more bewildering life. Just how powerful a role one's environment plays in shaping one's dream and sense of mission was on display throughout Horton's early life. The journey of this genius of a man. The story of Lowell Horton next on Jamaican Biography. People fascinates me, always have. Behind every big name Jamaican, I wondered, what is their story, motivation, dreams and aspirations? I want some amazing facts, childhood memories, achievements and disappointments. I wonder where they get their drive. Jamaican Biography gives me all of that and more. Welcome to the journey.
Jamaica, 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 Jamaica.
The rhythm sweet.
The rhythm sweet.
The rhythm sweet.
The not the rhythm sweet.
Not the.
The rhythm sweet.
The rhythm sweet.
The rhythm sweet.
One of 11 siblings, Lowell had the good fortune of an early exposure to business by helping his parents, Ephraim and Mavis, with the bakery they operated from 1949 in their community, Lawrence Tavern, a hilly country town in northern St. Andrew. This is where he got his first love for business. By the time he was a teenager, Horton had already developed a remarkable enterprising culture. While still at Oberlin High School, this resourceful youngster earned his own income by rearing chickens, pigs, and goats. At age 17, he had so much livestock that he was able to raise enough cash from their sale to fund his next business venture. I used the money to buy a minibus, he recalls. If Horton's childhood proved an early glimpse into the probable future of an entrepreneurial genius in the making, his teenage years would have left no doubt about it. Here is how he leveraged the minibus to the hilt. Mondays to Thursdays, the van plied the route between Halfway Tree and Lawrence Tavern. By Friday morning, all the seats would be out, creating space for a bread delivery that day and the following, to the anxiously awaiting market vendors and shop owners along the way from Buff Bay to Onanta Bay. The seats had to be back in place ahead of Sunday morning worship, so that churchgoers in and around Horton's community could have reliable transport to and from service. None of this activity was for free. I had to be paid, he points out. I was a busy teenager.
Yes.
Over 300 people turned up, and the support has just been tremendous. And I'm so happy that we have been able to provide for these students. You have heard their story, and my story is their story. And I'm so glad I can make a difference.
Horton says that an elder sister living in New York, Larice Campbell, filed for him in 1981, and that his intention was to spend a year in the City of Opportunity, save his money, and head back to Jamaica as the proud owner of the highly coveted coaster bus. That was every minibus driver's dream, to own a coaster and become president of the Minibus Association. Without a job, the plan began to unravel in slow motion, and the bragging rights that this single-minded youngster so passionately sought seemed to be slipping from his grasp. I was in New York for months without a job, he sighs. It is not clear at what point the would-be president of the Minibus Association conceded that the Jamaican plans would just not work out the way he hoped. But when he landed his first job as a stock handler at the New York City Police Department, NYPD, he quickly adjusted to the long-term reality of living in America. He enrolled at Bronx Community College and later City University of New York as an accounting student and began to climb the ladder at his workplace. With his accounting background, he started to do a little accounting work on the side to earn extra money. After nearly a decade in America, Horton's entrepreneurial bug began to bite. I wanted to do business, to carry on our parents' tradition. I always had the entrepreneurial spirit. I was always a businessman. He became the main promoter and driving force behind what was on paper a simple plan, a bakery.
It has been an amazing journey. But through it all, ups and downs, yes, we just stay fixed on the vision, yes, to fulfill the mandate that our parents give us, yes, to take the taste of the Caribbean to the world.
Seven of Horton's siblings resided in America, and all hands would have to be on deck for the business to succeed. One brother, Lloyd, had worked at a major New York bakery and had first-hand knowledge of the industry in America. He was also renowned for his baking talent. Another, Milton, had worked for Ford Motors and so had great mechanical skills. Lowell was the business visionary and the numbers man. I was a driving force behind the business. We came together in 1989 and I shared my vision with them. We talked about the potential and the source of funds. They bought into it and we came to the conclusion that we just had to do what we had to do to raise the funds, he explained. The fact that the financial institution initially backed at the idea of bankrolling the project did not deter this family. They mortgaged their houses, tap into personal savings and call on friends to raise the $107,000, which they calculated was the minimum it would take to get the business off the ground. With cash in hand, they leased a building in Bronx and bought used equipment. The business plan called for a wide range of baked products: bread, buns, patties, bulla, and takeout only service. Everything was exciting, recalls Horton, who had taken special long leave from his job at the NYPD to take charge of the family business. It was an experience for all of us to see the first customer walk in. Golden Cross was now in business.
My name is Lowell Hawthorne. I'm the president and CEO of Golden Cross Caribbean Bakery and Grill. Today marks a major milestone in the organization's history. We are celebrating 1 year since the Undercover Boss episode was aired. It has been a life-changing experience for me personally, not only for the organization, but for the employees and the Golden Cross team.
Horton's informal market survey had indicated that having the right location would be the key to the success of the bakery, but it was not until the first few months in operation that he realized just how pivotal the location would be and how far-sighted they were in their first choice of real estate. The building was across the road from the number 5 subway station on Gunnill Road, a place frequented by the intended target group of the products on offer, members of the Caribbean and Jamaica diaspora. The Hortons were spot on. Within months, the bakery had sold 100,000 worth of product. We clearly recognized that the location was good, says Horton. We knew we had a good chance of success. This store was a template for others that followed. We had a success story, the entrepreneur reckons. The model going forward was to put the stores beside Subway and the large Caribbean communities and near hospitals where lots of West Indians work. The success drove the pace of the expansion. When we saw the potential and revenue from one store and saw the number of family members we had to take care of, it drove us, he said. Within 3 years, there were 7 Golden Cross bakeries in operation, and by year 5, 17. The growth was fueled in part by a series of supply contracts that were won from several New York City agencies, from the prison of Rikers Island to the New York City school system, contracts from school districts in Mount Vernon and Rockland County also boosted sales. But the most rapid expansion phase was after 1996, with the far-reaching decision not just to add franchise outlets, but to shift the commercial model from 100% owned retail outlets to a franchise-based operation.
I have an amazing story, a story that's part of this book, The Baker's Son, with Mr. Lowell Hawthorne and his family and your family's history and what you have created, the Golden Crust Bakery, and that has become the largest bakery owned by people from the Caribbean. And that is an amazing story. Let's start with your father. Your father was the baker who created these tasty treats.
Yes, thank you, Herney. I want to welcome you to the Golden Crust's headquarters, home of the world's best tasting patties, as you can imagine.
Concomitantly, the Hortons decided to shift the concept from bakery to full-fledged restaurant that also served baked products. A 60,000 square foot centralized manufacturing facility was created in the Bronx to keep pace with the expansion in demand and to ensure product standardization across the network. In 2003, Horton deepened the management capacity of his organization. A vice president of franchising and director of franchise sales and development were two of the key posts that were created. That year, the firm also signed a deal with Pepsi USA for the drink giant to install soda fountains in Golden Crust restaurants and help the company with marketing. Currently, the central manufacturing facility in Bronx is 100,000 square feet in size. All the batters for all the 8 different types of patties that are sold throughout the franchise network are made there. They are transported in refrigerated containers on trailer to centralized distribution points in the south. From there, they are trucked to the various restaurants where they are baked and served to customers. The plant churns out 24,000 patty batters per hour, working 16-hour shifts each day, in addition, of course, to all the other products. Never short of innovation, the company has moved towards a concept called mini bakeries, 3 of which are currently in operation in Orlando, Atlanta, and Miami. At these locations, Golden Crust bread is mixed and baked from scratch.
Hi, I'm Lowell Hawthorne, President and CEO of Golden Crust. Introducing our newest and latest product, the Golden Crust Holiday Stout Bun. It is made with raisins, cherries, honey for extra goodness and real stout.
The main purpose is to ensure that the community can get fresh, authentic Ardour bread daily, explains Horton. With the expansion in the menu over the years, all the Golden Crust restaurants offer full Jamaican style meals like oxtail, jerk chicken, curried goat, and soup. These meals are cooked at the individual franchise operation using what Horton described as Golden Crust secret blend. They buy all the seasoning from us that we formulate in New York. It standardizes the taste throughout the network. Some of the restaurants are takeout only. Of the 122 stores up and running, most are franchises. We used to be 100% owned, but we find that with the franchise stores, we can focus on the manufacture, supply, and distribution logistics. We also create opportunities for other entrepreneurs. The ambience and feel of the Golden Crust restaurants are standard and have what Horton describes as the Golden Crust theme. The blue represents the Caribbean Sea, the flowery sand, and yellow walls and sunshine. The Caribbean music that is played in the stores is intended to create a Caribbean experience, he adds. Jamaica has been an important beneficiary of Golden Crust success, with farmers in St. Elizabeth and other communities having his restaurant chain as an important outlet for their produce. They supply ground provision like yam and seasoning such as curry, pepper, escallion, and thyme. We buy from a company in St. Elizabeth, which gets all the farmers to pool their resources, and the vendor then ship to us in the US, explains Horton. We get the cheese that we use in our bun and cheese through Grace Kennedy. The goods are shipped either to the main facility in New York or to the company's main distribution centers further south. A critical aspect of this cooperation is that 7 Horton brothers, sisters, and their spouses are involved in the operation. Lowell is the principal shareholder and executive chairman. His wife, Lorna, is director of human resources. His sister, Larice Campbell, runs the flagship store in Bronx, while another sister, Jacqueline Robinson, is in charge of the Atlanta-based stores. Brother Lloyd straddles Miami and Florida, while his wife, Velma, is the company's executive chef. Milton Horton helps to keep the machines in good working order. I have a wonderful staff and team and group of family members who are the unsung heroes of the success of this company, says Lowell. My family members are the founding and brave soldiers who shared my vision, dreams, and aspiration. They are the faith and trust that I would have delivered, and I think I have done that. Lowell Horton lived a story of achievement over adversity in the establishment and growth of his restaurant chain, Golden Crust Caribbean Bakery and Grill. Horton, who migrated to the United States in 1981, here are 10 things about Hawthorne's rise in business since he and 7 other siblings left Jamaica 36 years ago to join their older sister in America in a tough economic climate for restaurant businesses. 1. Hawthorne was an accountant by profession with the New York Police Department. 2. He went to the United States in 1981 with a dream to do the same kind of business that his parents ran in Jamaica for decades. 3. He took his father's recipe for making patties and started the first business in Bronx in 1989. 4. Hawthorne convinced his siblings to pull equity out of their homes and deplete their savings to invest over $107,000 in Golden Cross Bakery as a family business. 5. Between 1989 and 1993, he opened 17 stores under the brand as the largest Caribbean chain in the United States. 6. In 1995, he got the license to open as a franchise in New York, becoming one of the first Jamaicans to do so. Most of the stores were being operated by franchisees who invested a combined US $24 million. 7. Golden Cross now operates in 120 locations in 9 states. 8. In 2000, Hawthorne was named New York City Entrepreneur of the Year. 9. Every year, he awarded 2 scholarships in Jamaica and 1 to a college-born student in New York. In a tribute to his mother, on November 28, he posted on Facebook, "I was always in search of the next honest means to make a dollar. Like many transplanted Caribbean nationals, I struggled to work and raise a family. I can only thank God for everything I have achieved. If my story here can inspire others to rise up and give it a go, I would have accomplished something meaningful." He built the Jamaican beef patty Purevia into a national empire, boasting more than 120 restaurants across the United States. It also produced more than 50 million patties a year for retail stores and supplies them to about 20,000 outlets. "We believe in the power of the patty," Hawthorne, a former winner of the Observer's Business Leader Award, said in May. Hawthorne, who is often referred to as the Patty King, represented the best of Jamaica in the diaspora. Lowell was a true Jamaican patriot. He exemplified hard work, dignity, positive attitude, and high standards. Jamaica has lost a son, ambassador, and friend. Hawthorne was a popular person in the United States, especially in the diaspora, who generously supported many programs in his homeland over the years and remained true to the land of his birth. He has left behind a model for success that will serve many generations to come. A graduate of Oberlin High School in West Rural St. Andrew, Hawthorne, who went to the United States in 1981 in pursuit of the American dream, has defied all odds to actually find it. He, along with his family, built Golden Cross into the largest manufacturer of Jamaican patties overseas. The wonderful story and journey of this remarkable Jamaican unfortunately does not have a fairy tale ending, as on Saturday, December 2nd, 2017, at approximately 5:30 p.m., news broke that Lowell Hawthorne, age 57, had committed suicide in his Bronx factory. Subsequent reports suggest that his death might have been the result of a probe by the federal government over millions of dollars in tax evasion. Whatever the reasons were, this was definitely not the way such a great son of the soil should have made his final bow, in memory of the great man, Lowell Hawthorne.
Many in the Bronx and across the city are in disbelief over the apparent suicide of the owner of the Golden Crust restaurant chain. Police sources tell New York One Lowell Hawthorne shot and killed himself inside his Golden Crust Bakery headquarters in the Claremont section at around 5:30 yesterday evening. Sources say his body was found by a family member. Hawthorne was born in Jamaica and founded Golden Crust along with his family. Known for its beef patties and Jamaican dishes, the first Golden Crust opened in 1989 on Gun Hill Road. There are now more than 120 stores across the country. I've interviewed and spoken with Hawthorne many times, and he was known for his big smile and big laugh.
We started out the business basically trying to take care of my brothers, sisters, my wife, my children, the extended family. Started off with one store. After 2 years, we ended up with 3 stores. After 6 years, we had 17 stores. Never tired of eating beef patty. I've been eating beef patty since I was born.
This video was made possible through the continued generosity of my patrons. To become a patron, follow the link in the description below. Thank you for watching the video. Drop a like and a comment down below and consider subscribing if you haven't done so as yet. Until next time, walk good. Thank you for watching the video. Drop a like and a comment down below and consider subscribing if you haven't done so as yet. Until next time, walk good.